Hey, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the channel. As always, it is Nick here, back with your daily crypto news and analysis. And today we're going to be talking about Ripple and XRP. There's quite a bit of things to talk about, so sit back, relax, and before we fully jump into this video, I just want to ask if you guys could please leave a like on this video. It does help the channel grow immensely, and I do greatly appreciate it. Also, for anybody who does want to get my other crypto insights, my exit plans, and stuff like that, definitely go check out NCashOfficial.com. But with that in mind, let's just jump in. So we have been seeing the market range on a little bit here. We've been seeing Bitcoin kind of jumping around a little bit, still waiting for validation on Bitcoin to kind of go higher and retest the highs, and we have yet to get that. We want 53K. But I suspect that we're probably going to range on a little bit more here until we do see the market sentiment change. I will say this, I have been watching Bitcoin dominance and Ethereum dominance fairly closely. And right now, you know, things are looking fairly good with Bitcoin dominance at around the 40th percentile range. And of course, Ethereum at around 22%. That is why we are seeing Ethereum kind of, you know, a little bit, you know, in less, you know, water than Bitcoin on the 7-day span. Now, of course, with all of this in mind, we've been watching some things kind of unfold with XRP. I know from an overall perspective of an XRP holder, you know, you're probably not that excited about an 80, almost 2 cent XRP. But of course, you know, a lot of people are looking into this as being a buying opportunity, especially on the 7-day span. A lot of people did get to buy this juicy dip back here at around, you know, 73 cents or so. And accumulation has been happening. Now, I will say this. From an overall perspective, I think that these prices are going to look extremely different within some time. You know, if we are in that extended bull run, which I suspect that we are, in the next few months, we are going to see a lot of money flow throughout this entire market, and we're going to be seeing a lot of different prices for a lot of these altcoins. So I would say, you know, possibly, you know, screenshot the top 10 right now and look back on it in another, you know, few months, 3 to 6, you know, possible months, and kind of look at where the market is at now. Now, with that in mind, let's move on and let's talk about some exciting things. So, first and foremost, something that is not really that exciting, we did see XRP and also USDT pretty much get delisted from Newton Crypto. Now, this is a Canadian crypto exchange, and I thought this was actually fairly interesting that came out of absolutely nowhere, and it is including XRP and USDT, saying that it will no longer be supported on Newton as of January 15th, 2022, and the phase-out process will begin on December 20th. Now, this will end January 15th, as you guys do see here, and this is because of support for legal and regulatory reasons. So this is interesting, and a few other people did talk more so about it. We do see here, you know, they want to state the legal and regulatory reasons. From my understanding, XRP is not a security in Canada. And a lot of other people were commenting on this and talking more so about it, but I just think that this is odd to come out of nowhere. We've been seeing a few things like this. Going back a few months, there was like a smaller exchange that you know, pretty much said that they're delisting XRP, and a lot of people thought that it was for publicity reasons. I just think that there's something, you know, bigger at hand with this. Of course, in my mind, I'm still holding my XRP. I still have it in cold storage, so that is locked away, and I'm probably going to be holding it for a fairly long time unless we do get to some major high price targets. Now, with this in mind, we do see here, boom, Ripple offered new chance to argue for SEC documents on XRP, Ethereum, and Bitcoin. Game over, SEC have not submitted documents, judge told to the SEC 2 times. Now, in my mind, I think that we all just want clarity. I think that we just want clarification, and that is the overall issue here. You know, the SEC has claimed its internal documents, which include the agency's discussions over the nature of XRP and Ethereum, are protected by DPP or deliberative process privilege. And obviously, we want this clarification. We want to know why Ethereum and Bitcoin got the free pass. We want to know what discussions led up to that. And we're still not seeing that. This goes all the way back to August. In August 31st, in FaCE and Ripple and co-defendants' motion to compel the SEC to deliver the information, Judge Sarah Nepburn decided to perform an in-camera review of those documents. Now, like I said, with everything that's been going on in this market and in this case, for the longest time, we've just wanted clarification on these documents, and we are still not seeing that happen. I suspect that we will see this come to fruition very soon. In my mind, I think that this lawsuit is going to range on for a little bit of time, but I think that it's going to get settled at the perfect time. I think, in my mind, that a lot of people are probably going to get disgruntled with XRP, get frustrated with XRP, similar to 2017 and 2018, and then it's going to be the perfect storm. It's going to have a settlement, and it's going to be a bigger run than this bull run in 2017 and 2018. I suspect it's all pre-planned. I think that there's a lot of other, you know, things going on behind closed doors that a lot of us aren't seeing. I suspect that this is probably all a plan to, you know, pretty much, you know, usher in what is happening behind closed doors, which is the new system. I've been talking to you guys about this for a fairly long time. I know that it's a little bit of a tinfoil hat sort of, you know, idea, but with everything that's been happening, I suspect that Ripple and XRP are still the focus point, especially even in the US. I know that everybody's been thinking differently. They, you know, think that XRP is getting slowed down due to, you know, them ushering in something else like Swift GPI or Swift Go, because we've talked about that, or this new Visa sort of cross-border mechanism that they've been building. But I don't think that that's the case. In my mind, I think that they're trying to lengthen this lawsuit as much as possible to get more and more people out, and then it's going to be settled at the perfect time, and that's when we're going to see XRP really skyrocketing price. But we do see a Ripple integrator, Volante Tech, mentions Ripple in recent cross-border payments ebook, mentioned in Interesting Company. And we do see our next generation cross-border mechanisms such as Swift GPI, Ripple, Visa B2B, Visa Direct, and others are rapidly gaining traction. If banks do not modernize their legacy services, competitors will close the gap. And we are seeing that pretty much happen across the world right now. More so, I believe that XRP is being the number one choice overseas. It's becoming a racehorse for a lot of those countries that are adopting it into their ODL corridors and, you know, remittances, pretty much processes and products. And I think that that's helping them further innovation and pretty much march forward on into the next major payment, you know, revolution, which is what a lot of people think is the fourth industrial revolution of payments and pretty much, you know, just finance in general. Now, a lot of people, like I said, a lot of people call it XRP stablecoin. I just don't think that people realize what is happening behind closed doors. Like I said, you know, we look back on this and we're seeing, you know, Ripple Preview's liquidity hub to allow customers to buy, sell, and hold crypto assets. Now, this was actually with, there's a, I think it's in this article. Let me see. So, it's with CoinMe, so debuts alpha product with their first partner, CoinMe. Now, CoinMe actually is working with MoneyGram for their ATMs. The funny thing about CoinMe working with MoneyGram is we know that MoneyGram used to be a Ripple partner up until the SEC lawsuit. But do you honestly think that MoneyGram fully pulled out of the Ripple partnership? In my mind, I don't think any of the US-based customers pulled out of their partnerships, including Bank of America. But in my mind, this is such a huge innovation as well. Easy onboarding, optimizing pricing, access to capital as well. This is pretty huge. Now, I've discussed this. We've talked about this innovation. But this is just one step of, you know, the major, you know, update that is going to be happening for Ripple in the payments processing scene and market. Now, of course, we look on into other things as well. We just hear CIA says it has several projects on crypto. Now, the funny thing about this is I know that we're talking more so about Ripple here, but let's talk about Bitcoin, because I think in my mind, there's been a lot of things talking about, you know, if you will, conspiracy theories about Bitcoin having this, you know, sort of original alliance with the CIA and governments, where governments and the CIA are essentially the creators of Bitcoin. We don't know who created Bitcoin. There's been a lot of, like I said, conspiracy theories around it. Who knows, right? We do see her burn. CIA has established several projects on crypto, and we even see a quote like Bitcoin. What if that is the case? What if, you know, Bitcoin is, you know, a CIA or government pretty much, you know, creation? Or what if, and I've heard this one as well, what if Schwartz, David Schwartz, is the creator of Bitcoin? We know that he has the patent going all the way back to as like early as like 1990-ish, somewhere around that point, on DLTs. And pretty much, you know, we know that he's been in crypto for a fairly long time as well. So who knows? That could be interesting. But nonetheless, we also see USDT being printed or minted at the Tether Treasury. This was $1 billion. Now, I said, and so it continues, because we've been seeing this, you know, happen a few times now already this week, which of course is in regards to the market Could that money be flowing back into Bitcoin to allowing it, you know, to pump for an exit scheme? Who knows, right? We don't know exactly where that money's going to go. But also in terms of what is happening behind closed doors with XRP. And I know that I just jumped around a little bit. I do apologize. But in terms of what is happening with XRP, we look back on in time a little bit. We look back just, you know, last month, Lulu Exchange and Bank Alfala, I hope that I said that right, to boost cross-border payments via RippleNet. Now, I did talk more so about this, but this is more so to enhance the cross-border payment scene. And this is with the UAE to Pakistan. So, of course, they will have to utilize XRP in that, you know, scene. But I thought that this was funny because when we're talking about ODL adoption and, you know, what is happening overseas, you know, these are major banks that are utilizing this technology. So you are going to tell me that right now that the U.S. doesn't see this happening across the world in terms of ODL adoption and utility pretty much being brought up around Ripple's name and XRP, but they're not going to advance their cross-border scene or their payment experiences with RippleNet or XRP just because it's being sued by the SEC? Absolutely not. I don't think that that is the case. I think that the U.S. is obviously seeing that they are losing the digitized race, and I think that they are inside working with RippleNet and XRP probably without even announcing anything, and it's all happening behind the scenes. Like I said, tinfoil hat wearing, but of course, that is what I'm speculating a little bit. Now, we will obviously see all this come to fruition if, and like I say, if we do see a settlement happening very soon, which in my mind, I do think that we do. I think that there's just a lot pretty much ranging on that. Now, we also see our top South Korean money transfer firm joins RippleNet to further remittances to Thailand. Like I said, it's and also we do see our Ripple is focusing on Asia, which the company has said is the fastest growing market. And it is for crypto. We have been seeing some major innovation happening overseas, especially in Asia. Now, we do see here one of South Korea's largest remittances services firms has joined Ripple's network of institutional payment providers, which we do know is like 300 plus. We know that top 38 banks out of the top 100 are already working with Ripple or trialing Ripple, which we know that that was from 2019. So there's probably a lot more. There's probably like a top 50 at least. But we do see here Ripple is focusing on Asia, which the company has said is the fastest growing market, with the number of transactions growing 130% year over year. Okay, and this is also the needs of some 184,000 Thai nationals residing in South Korea. So it's pretty interesting, and it's a pretty big use case as well. But this is just one of many that has been happening in just the last couple months. Like, this is from August. This is from November 15th. And there's so much more, right? We even go back to August 4th, right? When we did see this, Ripple's blueprint to modernize Europe's payment infrastructure, payment source. Now, they are talking about Europe. They're talking about also focusing on Asia as well. They're talking about the sluggish, pretty much cross-border scene and, you know, the payments scene as well. They're going to revolutionize this scene. And in my mind, there is no other asset that is well positioned like RippleNet with XRP in this market at all to really kind of disrupt this entire scene. They are focusing on cross-border payments with B2B payments and for financial institutions alike. That is why I suspect that Ripple and XRP are going to be much bigger than what anybody actually sees. Like, you know, in my mind, yeah, sure. It makes sense to sell XRP and reinvest during the bear market. I know everybody's worried about it and concerned about, you know, what if the utility-driven market's just right around the corner? What if they flip the switch? I don't listen to any of that. In fact, I don't care about the whole idea of flipping the switch. Trust me, it will get to that point, but it's going to take years to get to that point. But I think that we're very close to it, especially with ISO 222 coming next year, or like almost a year from now. That's going to be the, you know, match that starts the fire. But the fire is going to take a little bit of time to really get to the point where it really burns really, really, really big in terms of a massive pretty much catalyst event where we do see the utility-driven market growing and growing and growing within the scene. That is why I still think that in terms of the cycle, I still think that we are going to see that extended cycle. Same with how we've seen pretty much since the dawn of time of crypto. 2013 to 2014 to 2017 and 2018 looks a little bit different in terms of a lengthened cycle by like almost 100 days, right? And when we're talking about that, in my mind, I think that we're still in the lengthened cycle. I still think that we're going to see some major gains on XRP where we're going to be able to sell and take our profit and then re-up our bag by 2 to 4x. And then we're going to be able to sit on it for when the real market happens. And when the real market happens, which I call the utility-driven market, when Bitcoin does get replaced by possibly Ethereum or some sort of DLT technology in the space that is doing, you know, billions of transactions a day, a month, whatever the case may be, and being utilized on a day-to-day basis, that's going to be the point where we do succeed greatly and make generational wealth on all of our assets that we are holding for a fairly long time, like XRP, QNT, HBAR, AOBT, all of these major incredible, you know, gems that are going to deliver us incredible opportunities. I know people get tired of hearing about XRP, you know, especially with a lot of YouTubers saying, you know, I'm going to be able to buy a house with just one XRP. Like, I think that that mentality is a little bit too crazy to fathom right now for a lot of individuals. But in the future, I think that XRP has a solid price tag on it. We don't know exactly what that value will be, but we do know that XRP does have to be worth a lot more than 81.5 cents or a dollar or $8 or $10 or even $50, right? It needs to be worth a lot more because the amount of volume that is going to be delivered over the Ripple net, you know, network utilizing XRP, because these are all cross-border payments. And when you utilize something like the Ripple net, you need the bridge currency, which is XRP for any cross-border payment experience. And that is exactly what is happening right now. They are launching many of these, you know, pretty much use cases within the cross-border payment scene. You know, just to give you guys an idea, Ripple and Bank DeFar, to deliver real-time payments from Oman to India via RippleNet. Understand what you hold, because even this year alone, we have been seeing India has no plans to recognize Bitcoin as currency. RBI working on CBDC rollout report. Okay, they are not going to choose Bitcoin. They understand that Bitcoin is just not utilized, you know, the correct way. It's not going to ever be utilized in the payment scene because it needs something like the Lightning Network. XRP, though, could be utilized within the payment scene because RippleNet itself is utilizing XRP on a day-to-day basis for those cross-border payments. That is why it's perfectly positioned to be worth well more than $10 to $50 to even $100 because it's going to be utilized on a day-to-day basis for cross-border payments that are going to be worth trillions of dollars a year. You know, we look back on Nostro Vostro accounts worth $27 trillion in transactional volume just, you know, a year, or I should say in liquidity a year. And then we look back on like the derivatives market, the payments, you know, a year for B2B and P2P and stuff like that. XRP's price is going to be worth well beyond what anybody really suspects. And I am going to be here for it. I'm going to be watching XRP very closely. I think that this is one of the most solid investments in the space. Everybody calls XRP a stablecoin. Everybody talks down on XRP. But in my mind, the utility behind it is unmatched by really any other asset in the space because it is solving the liquidity crisis problem. No other asset has that type of technology. On-demand liquidity through the RippleNet network is something that is not like any other use case. It's similar to interoperability with QNT. There is nothing like it. So with that in mind, I hope that you all enjoyed this video. If you guys did, definitely leave a like, subscribe, turn notifications on. If you guys want more free content, you guys are more than welcome to follow me on Twitter and join the free Discord down in the description below. As always, I hope that you all have a beautiful day or a beautiful night, wherever you guys are. And this has been Nick. Peace out, guys.